Hey guys, it's Medicosis Perfectionatus, where medicine makes perfect sense. Let's continue our biology playlist. We have just finished the endocrine biology. Today we'll start respiratory system biology. And here is a brief discussion of the anatomy of the respiratory system. This is my biology playlist intended for students who are getting started. But if you are a pro, there is a pulmonology playlist on my YouTube channel where you will learn about all of this nonsense. Let's start at the beginning. We start here. You breathe in via your nose or your mouth, regardless of the orifice that you use, although I recommend you use your nose. Either way, you will end up here in the pharynx. And the pharynx is a large, big tube right here. And it's divided into three pieces. The part of the pharynx behind the nose is called the nasopharynx. The part of the pharynx behind the mouth or the oral cavity is called the oropharynx. The part of the pharynx behind the larynx is called the laryngopharynx. So let's go back to square one. We had air here. We're breathing air in. And then we go from nose to pharynx or mouth to pharynx. And then what? And then you will go here to the laryngopharynx, and then into the larynx, which is here, covered by the epiglottis. Down goes the trachea, or the trachea. And then the trachea is gonna divide into right and left main stem bronchi. Here is a bronchus, here is a bronchus. This is called the right main stem bronchus, this is the left main stem bronchus. Each bronchus will give you bronchioles. The bronchioles in the beginning, proximally, are known as terminal bronchioles. And then when you go deeper, they become respiratory bronchioles. So let's do it again. Nose, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, bronchioles, alveolar ducts, and then alveoli. What are the alveoli? Teeny tiny sacs like this. What's the function? Two functions. Number one, gas exchange. Number two, secrete surfactant. What do you mean by gas exchange? Get oxygen into your body, get carbon dioxide away from your body. Why do you need a surfactant? Well, a surfactant is anti-surface tension. Surface tension wants to collapse your lungs. The surfactant is anti-surface tension, therefore it will prevent lung collapse so that you can breathe. Beautiful. The lung has many functions, including to get the oxygen into your body and to remove the carbon dioxide away from your body. The question is, which one is more important? Oh, I know, Medicosis. Of course, getting oxygen in. Shut up. Getting carbon dioxide out is way more important than getting the oxygen in. How come? Let me explain. Let's say that your oxygen saturation deteriorated and decreased from 99% to 94%. So now your red blood cells are carrying less oxygen. What's going to happen to a real patient in real life if you decrease from 99% to 94%? Oh well, nothing. You can survive it. But carbon dioxide is responsible for the pH of your body. You know what's going to happen if the pH of your body decreases from 7.4 to 6.8? You're gone. You know what's going to happen if your pH increased from 7.4 to 8.2? Well, I'll need to borrow René Descartes' philosophy and doubt your own existence. Carbon dioxide influences the pH of your blood, and life is only possible within a very narrow range of pH change. That was deep, but this quote is not mine. I borrowed it from an Egyptian professor. Functions of the freaking respiratory system. So, regulation of acid-base balance. Of course, because carbon dioxide is an acid. How come? Carbon dioxide plus water will give you carbonic acid. Say it again.
Carbonic acid.
Yeah, it's an acid. It can cause acidosis. If you keep piling up and accumulating carbon dioxide in your blood, you get respiratory acidosis, which can kill you. If you keep removing out carbon dioxide from the system, you can get respiratory alkalosis, which can also kill you. Because carbon dioxide is an acid. If you have more acid, you have acidosis. If the acid is leaving, you have alkalosis. How does that happen? Let's say that you are breathing less often. So instead of normal, you're breathing like this.
Do
You're breathing less. Therefore, you're not removing carbon dioxide from your body. Therefore, carbon dioxide is going to accumulate in your body. Carbon dioxide is an acid. You'll get respiratory acidosis, which is dangerous. Conversely, if you're breathing too fast like this, you're washing out carbon dioxide. You're losing the acid and developing alkalosis. And of course, you know, when you have acidosis, there is low pH. And when you have alkalosis, there is high pH. Because pH is the inverse of the hydrogen ion concentration. If you remember your chemistry, pH equals negative log, and then here you have the hydrogen ion concentration. Therefore, the higher the hydrogen ion concentration, the lower your pH. We call this acidosis. Next, respiratory system is responsible for regulating your water balance because you keep breathing in or breathing out air which includes and contains water vapor. Your respiratory system is robust because it includes macrophages, mast cells, lysozymes. These are enzymes that cause lysis for the foreign invaders. And in your nose, there is IgA because IgA ascends to the mucous membranes. So whenever you're talking about a mucous membrane, such as your mouth, your nose, your larynx, your pharynx, they have IgA. IgA is an antibody that's going to destroy those foreign invaders. But what if I have a disease like this, Mycoplasma pneumoniae? This is a bacteria that can cause pneumonia. Why is this dangerous? Because this bacteria destroys your epithelium, destroys your mucous membrane, including those defense mechanisms. My defense mechanisms are now toast. I can get a disease. Next, in a few minutes, we will talk about the pleura. The intrapleural pressure is negative. If you have a negative pressure in your thorax, in your chest, this will pull and suck blood from your feet up to your heart, which will improve the venous return from your lower extremities and back to the heart. Lungs contain angiotensin-converting enzyme, or ACE. What's the function of the angiotensin-converting enzyme, which we have discussed before? It's to convert angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, because it's the angiotensin-converting enzyme. No duh. Respiratory system includes the larynx, which is important for vocalization. It also includes the nose, which is important for olfaction. At the roof of the nose, there is bone known as the ethmoid bone. This bone is pierced by teeny tiny sensory fibers of the olfactory nerve. And the olfactory nerve is cranial nerve number 1. What's the function of the olfactory nerve? Olfaction? No kidding. Smelling. This is the sensory nerve for smell sensation. It carries impulses from your nose to your brain so that I can realize that you stink and you need to take a shower. Respiratory system is also responsible for thermoregulation because you have tons of capillaries in your respiratory system. If you vasoconstrict those capillaries, you will retain heat. But if you vasodilate, you will evaporate and dissipate the heat. Why does your nose turn blue in harsh winter nights? It's because of severe vasoconstriction in your nose because your body is trying to retain heat. Otherwise, you will die from hypothermia. We have two types of respiration, external respiration and internal respiration. When you breathe in and breathe out like this, inhalation, exhalation, inspiration, expiration, you're doing external respiration or external breathing. You also have internal breathing or cellular respiration. This is the story of your mitochondria with its TCA cycle and electron transport chain. To make what? To get ATP. Do you remember glycolysis? TCA cycle, electron transport chain? Yeah, basically you were burning glucose in the presence of oxygen and getting energy while releasing carbon dioxide. Where will that carbon dioxide go? Well, you will exhale it. Respiratory tract can be divided into upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract. Upper, nose or mouth, pharynx, larynx, and then the lower includes the tracheobronchial tree, which includes the trachea, bronchi, and bronchioles, and then the alveoli. Sorry about the typo. There is another functional classification, conducting zone versus respiratory zone. Conducting zone starts at the tip of your nose, ends in the terminal bronchioles. Remember we went trachea, bronchi, terminal bronchioles. How about the respiratory bronchioles? No, these will come later and they are part of the respiratory zone. So when you are superficial near your nose, this is conducting zone. As you go deeper and deeper and deeper toward your alveoli, this is respiratory zone. In the conducting zone, there is no gas exchange, but in the respiratory zone, there is gas exchange because there is alveoli. So what's the function of the conducting zone? Well, it has mucus, it has the escalator to get all of the debris out of your body, it has some macrophages, it has IgA, lysozymes for foreign invaders, etc. But what's the function of respiratory zone? Two functions. Number one, gas exchange. Number two, give me the surfactant. Why do you need gas exchange? To get the oxygen in and get the carbon dioxide out. Which one is more important? Getting the carbon dioxide out is more important because we're talking about the pH here. Carbon dioxide is a freaking acid. Why do you need surfactant? Because it's anti-surface tension. Surface tension wants your lung to collapse. Surfactant is gonna keep your lungs open. A sneaky question that can sneak upon you on the exam. They will ask you,
you see this right main stem bronchus and this left main stem bronchus?
Yeah.
Is there a difference?
Oh yeah, there is a difference. The right bronchus is shorter, wider, and more vertical. The right one is more like this, more vertical. But the left one is more like this, more horizontal. Therefore, if I'm a bacteria trying to sneak into your lungs, of course it's easier for me to go to the right lung than the left lung, because it's called gravity, baby. If I inhaled a peanut, same thing. It's easier for the peanut to end up in your right lung than the left lung. Oh, by the way, if you haven't noticed already, your right is the patient left and your left is the patient right. We're talking here about a person looking at you dead in the eyes. The lungs are encased by a beautiful chest wall, which includes bones, muscles, and joints. The bones are the ribs, the sternum, the clavicle, and the vertebrae. The muscles are intercostal muscles. By the way, during normal, quiet breathing, you only need muscles during inspiration. But you do not need muscles during expiration, because it's a passive process. Inhalation, active, needs muscles. Exhalation, passive, no muscles need. We're talking about the quiet breathing. But if you're running from a tiger, it's a different story. What's the most important respiratory muscle? The diaphragm. Can I live with just a half? Yes, you can. If medicosis has helped you last year, please consider buying me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/medicosis. Thank you so much for your support. Look at this. You see this? This is the right lung and this is the left lung. How many lobes are in the right lung? Here is a lobe, here is a lobe, here is a lobe. So the right lung has three pieces. Each one is known as a lobe. This is the upper lobe, middle lobe, and guess what? Lower lobe.
Why is it so small like this?
Well, it is small if you are looking from the front of the patient, but it's going to continue at the back of the lung, so it's not that short. Look at the left lung. Only two lobes, upper lobe, lower lobe. Why do we have three lobes in one lung and two lobes in the other lung? Because you have to account for the heart. The heart is a central structure with the apex going slightly towards the left. So the heart is huge. It's taking a chunk from the left lung, and that's why the left lung only has two lobes. What's the equivalent of the right middle lobe on the left side? It's a teeny tiny piece called the lingula. What are these? These are your lungs. What's that? That's the diaphragm. During inspiration, it contracts and descends downwards. This will expand your lungs so that you can get the air in. During expiration, it's gonna relax and move upwards, and therefore you're gonna empty your lungs and get the air out. The lungs are surrounded by the pleura. The pleura is a very thin cover that surrounds the lung, one for the left lung, one for the right lung. The pleura is made of two layers. An inner layer hugging the lung is called the visceral pleura, an outer layer away from the lung but closer to the chest wall, the bones and muscles here, and it's called the parietal pleura. All right, between the visceral pleura and the parietal pleura, there is a very teeny tiny space filled with a thin layer of fluid known as the pleural fluid. This is a very thin layer, like a drop between two glass slides that you see in the lab that you use under the microscope. Oh, by the way, these notes, these slides that you see right now, are downloadable at medicosisperfectsnatus.com. If you love this video, you will like my CNS pharmacology course on my website, medicosisperfectsnatus.com. I also have a cardiac pharmacology course. If you are a lovely person who studies in January, you are a unicorn, because every people is like, oh, it's the new year, let me just relax. But not you, my friend, you want to learn. And here's a 60% discount towards any product on my website. Just use discount code NEWYEARLEARNING in one word. All of my premium courses and the notes to this biology series are available at medicosisperfectsnatus.com. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and click on the join button. You can support me here or here. Go to my website, download my courses. Be safe, stay happy, study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense.